Please join me in welcoming Dr. Nader Ghasemlou for his talk, It's Time for a Better Way to Treat Chronic Pain.
When I was in grade 11, getting ready for final exams, I was in the kitchen with my brother making macaroni and cheese. We were listening to Jimi Hendrix on the record player. And I knew the song, but for some reason, I kept repeating the same lyric over and over and over again. I turned to him to ask him if he was having the same problem, but before I knew it, I was falling over and having the first seizure that I had ever had. He panicked. I'd gone blue, couldn't breathe for 1 or 2 minutes. I called the ambulance to come and get me. When I finally woke up on the kitchen floor, there was a pain in my head that felt as if someone had put a pickaxe into it. It was really bad. Went through a couple of days of tests and imaging with doctors to figure out what was wrong. Now, two bright spots did come up. First, I didn't have to do those final exams in grade 11. And second, because I was going to have surgery, they were going to shave my head. And so I got to dye my hair. I went blonde, which it turns out is not a good look for this guy. So what happened? The doctors had found a tumor about 2 centimeters cubed, size of my thumb, that they had to remove. When the surgery was done and I woke up, I realized that I was paralyzed on my left side. Couldn't move, couldn't feel. I was in the hospital for about 2 months, undergoing daily rehabilitation and physical therapy, trying to regain function, get back to normal again. One of the very first tests I'll never forget, medical student came in and said she was going to poke me. And I was going to tell her when I felt something. So she put a piece of cardboard in front of my hand so that I wouldn't see. And I was looking at my parents just to prove that I'm not cheating at this test. Before I realized it, they had a look of worry on their faces. So I looked back at the medical student, and she pulled away the piece of cardboard. She said, "I've tried every filament. You can't feel a thing." And there I was, looking at my hand, and thinking, that is so cool. I can't feel a thing. And so began my interest in pain and understanding why and how we feel. My name is Nader Ghasemlou, and I'm a professor at Queen's University in the departments of biomedical and molecular sciences and anesthesiology, where I lead the pain, chronobiology, and neuroimmunology laboratory. Pain, chronobiology, and neuroimmunology. Those are, it's a lot of words. There's a lot of mixing of words in there, so let's walk through it together. Pain. We all know what pain is. It's that unpleasant sensory experience that you feel when there's damage or disease. Chronobiology. The sun comes up in the morning, we wake up. The sun goes down at night, we go to sleep. That 24-hour rhythm is called the circadian rhythm. Well, this idea of time affecting our biology is called chronobiology. Neuroimmunology. Well, when the nervous and the immune system talk to each other, it means that there's usually something bad going on, like injury or disease. Well, since I took you back 30 years to when I had brain surgery, let's go back 2,000 years to the Roman physician Celsus, who first described the 4 pillars of inflammation: heat, redness, swelling, and pain. Now, if you're like me in the kitchen, you often don't pay attention, you may touch a hot pan. That immediate response, that hurts. That's your nervous system telling you, be careful, that's gonna cause damage. The heat, redness, and swelling that comes afterwards is your immune system coming in to clean up the debris that's there, the damage that's occurred. There's miscommunication that happens sometimes between these two systems. One of the things that we have to think about with this is, how do we control it and how do we understand it? that pain that's there, dull, throbbing. You touch something by accident, sharp, stabbing pain. Imagine living with that every single day. Imagine if putting on a sweater in the morning makes your skin burn. Imagine if you can't bend over to pick up your grandchild. Imagine if you can't go out on a walk on a beautiful day like today because it just hurts. You could be one of the 1 in 5 Canadians and people all around this world living with chronic pain. Now, it could be that you have this chronic pain because you work in a factory and have a repetitive job. It could be because you fell on the ice awkwardly 5 winters ago. It could be because you're one of the unlucky people who, as they age, develops arthritis. You would take whatever medicine there is to get better, to get back to your normal self. Well, one of the good things is that this year we had a drug approved specifically for the treatment of pain. The last time this happened was 25 years ago. And before that, you'd have to go back another 50 years for a drug that was there to specifically treat pain. In fact, to this day, the gold standard drug used to treat chronic pain is opioids. These were described over 8,000 years ago in Sumerian clay tablets, and yet they remain the gold standard drug that we have. But we're doing all this research in the laboratory, and there's so few options for our patients. This is what we in research call the valley of death, where good drugs and ideas go to die. And pain medicine is where this valley is the worst of all. Time, understanding it and how it works. Well, sometimes you have time to do things and sometimes you don't. When my wife and I were doing our postdoctoral fellowships, we had one child and then we had the second. Things change when you've got two kids. You go from playing zone defense to man on man. Your times are messed up, your schedules are messed up. You can't go to work when you want to, you can't eat when you want to. Well, I was running an experiment as a postdoctoral fellow and had to go in late at night one day to test for the pain signals that I knew were going to be there, but they weren't. I thought, did I do something wrong? What's happening? Went back the next day during the afternoon to test. Pain signals were there. What's going on? Go back in at night again. Get permission first. Can I go in late at night? Yeah, you can go. Go in and check. Pain signals are gone again. I had discovered a rhythm to pain in the laboratory. Interesting. Chronobiology. Now, when we run a clinical trial, a really good clinical trial that's testing for pain, they will ask the participants to rate their pain on a scale of 0 to 10. 0, no pain at all. 10, the worst pain you've ever felt. Kind of like how I felt after that first seizure. A really good study will ask participants to rate their pain once a day. The questions will vary though. What's your pain like right now? What was the average pain that you felt over the last 24 hours? Or what was your worst pain that you had today? The numbers are variable and are going to depend on the individual. Now, that was a great study. Most studies will ask participants to rate their pain once a week. Who knows what score they're going to give you on that piece of paper and pencil? Is it going to be their pain right now as I'm filling it out? Is it the worst pain that I felt this week? Or is it a pain score linked to some event or memory that I have from the past week? We just don't know. There's variability to what we're seeing. We wanted to ask whether or not the rhythms of pain that we saw in the laboratory exist in people. So what did we do? We went ahead and developed a digital tool, an electronic diary, and asked people with chronic pain to rate their pain at 3 times of day over 7 days, 8 a.m., 2 p.m., and 8 p.m. What we found was both expected and surprising. What was expected? Most people live with constant pain every single day of their lives. A 5 on 10, let's say. But there was a special group of people who didn't have that constant pain. They'd rate their pain in the morning at a 2 or a 3 on 10. In the afternoon, it'd go up a little bit, 4 or 5. In the evening, 6 or 7. It hurts. The next day, they are back down to a 2. And the cycle would repeat itself. Chronobiology. Now, like I said, we are the pain, chronobiology, and neuroimmunology lab. So we decided to act like scientists and take samples from these participants. And so we drew their blood. And we asked the question of, what's different? It turns out, the immune cells that are there weren't different. But the gene signatures at the molecular level were. The people that had a rhythm to their pain had a rhythm to their genes, turning on and off, like the sun coming up and down. Are these rhythms important? Of course they are. Did you know that the people most likely to develop a chronic disease like multiple sclerosis or cancer or cardiovascular disease are shift workers, like nurses and police officers? We found out in the lab that individual cells have a rhythm. And if you disrupt the rhythm of one cell, it disrupts the rhythm of the cell next to it. If you disrupt the rhythm of one cell, it disrupts the rhythm of the whole organ. If you disrupt one cell, the whole system can break down. Rhythms. These rhythms are important. The most important thing about these people that had a rhythm to their pain was that not one of them was taking an opioid. These rhythms are important. So my lab now is trying to work out what it means to have a rhythm, what it means to modulate these rhythms, to understand these rhythms at the cellular and the molecular level. We think this is a paradigm shift in terms of how we have to think about pain, how we have to think about chronobiology, neuroimmunology, and how we have to think about the clinical trials that we're running. Imagine if by resetting someone's clock, you can reset their pain. Imagine if by resetting someone's clock, you can get them off of opioids. Imagine if by resetting clocks, we can rethink what chronic disease is. This is what excites me, and I hope you'll imagine what's next with me. Thank you.